So, assalamu alaikum. We are gathered here today to discuss a very important issue. In fact, experts have described it as the number one problem for Pakistan today. Water is life, and the earliest civilizations were built around water, like our Indus Valley civilization. In this part of the world, however, we either have too much water in the form of floods or too little water in the form of droughts. And climate change and a rapidly expanding population are just making all our water problems much worse. We have gone from being a water surplus to water stressed country, and we are soon going to have water scarcity. The per capita water availability has reduced from approximately 5,000 cubic meters per year to around 1,000 cubic meters per year. According to the World Bank, Pakistan is now heading towards water availability of less than 1,000 cubic meters per year per person by 2035. We are now part of a group of countries where there will be scarcity of water. Our population is completely dependent on the Indus River system for its fresh water. More than 50%, and some say up to 70% of that water comes from melting snow and glaciers. Around 90 to 95% of that water is used in agriculture, while 4 to 5% is for domestic use and for industry. It is in the agriculture sector that there is the greatest wastage of water. In Pakistan, the talk when it comes to water is all about hard infrastructure solutions like building dams. But no one really talks about the water that is wasted in agriculture. Luckily, we today have an expert on our panel who will talk about bringing in greater efficiency into our outdated irrigation system. And of course, it is a woman, Erum Sattar. Research focuses on issues of water federalism and transboundary water sharing in the Indus River Basin. She teaches water law and policy and environment law at Pace University School of Law, Northeastern University School of Law, and Tufts University in the US. I don't think I even need to introduce our next panelist, the former Chief Justice of Pakistan, Saqib Nisar, who set up the Prime Minister and Chief Justice of Pakistan's the Amir Bhasha and Muhammad Dam Fund in July 2018. The former Chief Justice is now a household name, and there is no doubt that it is because of his campaigning that people across Pakistan have become aware of water scarcity. Last but not least, we have a new panelist, Ahmed Khan Bhatti Saab. And he's a former member of the Water and Power Authority.
Member of Water.
And he is heading a public institute on hydropower. So he's standing in for Shamsul Mulk Saab, who couldn't make it today. So I will start with a round of questions. I really look forward to the discussion because I'm a journalist and I write about water and climate change, but you know, I really feel I need to learn more. It's a very complex subject. I don't think I know enough about it. And so I'll ask him a round of questions and get the debate going, and then I'll open it up to the public because I think lots of people in the audience will also want to join in, and I'm sure they have you know, questions to ask. So I'll leave about 20 minutes at the end. So, so let's start with the former Chief Justice. Sir, what personally motivated you to start this fund for the Amar Bhasha and Momand? And I believe you have a small presentation you would like to give us. So aap podium par aa jaye and aap, you can start your presentation.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Respected organizers of this function, distinguished guests, it's my proud privilege to be here today, particularly talking about an issue, a grave and a very important issue, which Pakistan is facing for a considerable time, And the resolution of this issue is most expedient for us. Actually, I was not asked to prepare any presentation for this function today, but I can give you a brief preview of what made me think about the construction of this dam. I was in Karachi, and prior to my taking over as the Chief Justice of Pakistan, on account of scarcity of water in Karachi and Karachi being confronted with the tankers who would provide water to even the houses on a very high price, a commission was constituted under the chairmanship of the judge of the Sindh High Court, who gave a very comprehensive report indicating as to why the scarcity of water, in particular in the region of Karachi, and what are the causes and what should be the steps taken to resolve this issue. Then I made an in-depth study and applied my mind to that. I came across that it is only because we have a scarcity of water all over. I constituted a water commission headed by retired Justice Muslim Hani. And I accurately remember that is the point of time when this seed of brooding about the construction of the dam and for the restoration or increase of our water resources came to my mind. I've been discussing this issue with Shamsul Mulk Sahab, who unfortunately could not make today. Immediately thereafter, I happened to be in Quetta. I remember it was late night, we were holding the court, and both the ex-chief ministers, Mr. Malik, as also Mr. Zari, they were present in the court giving us some information about the water issue and the predicament which was being faced by the people of Quetta. The ground level in Quetta, do you believe, has gone down to the extent of 1,500 to 2,000 feet. And there was a real fear that it could possibly lead to a massive migration from Quetta because people of Quetta were facing this issue at a very massive scale. Having known about the gravity of the problem, first of all, I had a presentation in the open court by Mr. Zafar Mahmood, ex-chairman WABDA, who gave me the presentation and explained as to how imperative and expedient, particularly speaking about the Kalabagh Dam, it was that we must construct Kalabagh Dam immediately, otherwise the situation, the grave situation of water scarcity in Pakistan would be insurmountable. It was an open discussion in the court, a presentation given where some of our friends from the group which felt that Kalabagh Dam should not be built, they also raised certain objections. Ladies and gentlemen, that is the point of time when I thought that if Kalabagh Dam cannot be made because of this unfortunate situation, that we are not on one page. All the brothers, the four brothers, all the provinces are not on one page. At least we need to construct a Pakistan dam. We give it a name, Pakistan Dam. And that is where I started consideration, started considering as to what other options we have. And this is how we proceeded with the matter. We constituted under Law and Justice Commission a committee comprising of the Chairman Wabda, Mr. Shamsul Mulk, Panning Divian people, Watan Pa, so many other experts. And then this committee made certain suggestions, and ultimately the matter was taken up in the court. Here I find it to be my profound duty at least to apprise you as to why we did take up this matter to the court. And let me share with you that in our constitution it's a beauty that we have fundamental rights. In every democracy, the most important and primordial rights which the citizens of that country has are the fundamental rights. And to our good luck, the first and the utmost right in our constitution is the right to life, which is not restricted to only the right to existence alone. It's a right which must have all the facets of right to life, all the traits of right to life, the quality life, right to live with dignity, right to live with prestige, right to live with comfort, right to live with health. It is on account of water that we have life on earth. Otherwise, earth would have been like any other barren planet in the universe. It is only this great gift of the God Almighty that we, as human beings, the mankind, and this is why the earth is unique. That is the reason connecting this water scarcity issue, which is sine qua non for any living organism, that we decided to take up this matter in the open court and we initiated the hearings with this. Directly connected with the right of life, and on account of the fact that Pakistan is one of the most stressed water countries in the world, in order to secure the fundamental right to life, that he passed the orders in terms of Article 184.3 of the Constitution of Islamic Republic of Pakistan. If there is no paucity of time, let me briefly explain to you the scope of Article 184.3 of the Constitution in the simplest manner. Article 184.3 mentions that if there is a question of fundamental right and the matter is of public importance, the Supreme Court of Pakistan has unbridled, unfettered jurisdiction to enforce that right for the public good. And that is exactly what the Supreme Court has done by virtue of issuing a direction to the government of Pakistan that for the purposes of securing the right to life, which was attached, instilled, integrated with the water, that the water issue must be taken up as a priority and must be resolved.
Thank you, Justice. Can we bring in the others? Because then I want the audience to be able to ask you questions.
Thank you very much. So this is basically the reason, just to secure and save the right to life, that we had passed this order under Article 184.3. Rest I leave the audience. If they have any questions, I'll be pleased to answer those.
Ahmed Saab, you are actually the only trained civil engineer on the panel. So do you hold the view that Pakistan has very little capacity to store rain and glacial waters and is losing whatever capacity it has due to the silting of our dams in Tarbela and Mangla?
Yes, we. First of all, I do realize that. But before I answer your question, I just would like to a few comments on what Saqib Nisar. In my 40 long years of service as a professional civil engineer in the water resources management and development of Pakistan, we tried in so many seminars and so many forums to sensitize the people of Pakistan about the water scarcity issues and the looming water crisis. But it never worked. We never succeeded. We could not make people realize about the issue. I would certainly like to compliment that what we, the entire engineering community related to water, could not do all these years, the former Chief Justice of Pakistan did it in just a few months. So, and I believe that our water resources, whatever we have, are almost fully committed or utilized. So water security is now tied to, strictly to water management, and primarily from the demand side. Now, the water management can only succeed if the people are aware of what is the availability of water. And the governance of water can only improve with the participation of the people. That's where a very big initiative has already taken place. So as to now the question that we are the reservoir at the moment, we have, of course, they will not be able, they are being silted up, and we got to go for additional storages. But I also would like to make it clear that our water sources, dams, our groundwater is not a resource. Our primary resource of water is what falls from the heavens. That is the precipitation, the snowfall, and the rainfall. And most of it lies in the catchments that belong, don't belong to us. Mm-hmm. The issue has been further complicated by climate change issues, and the uncertainty of how India is going to behave relating to the areas which is under their control. So this leaves us with no option to us but to have more storages wherever they are feasible, and also to develop underground storages, surface storages as well as underground storages, so that we can resolve this issue.
Okay, thank you. Erum, I'd like to bring you into the discussion now. So you hold the view that, actually I'm quoting from your latest article, one of your recent articles, there needs to be a humble recognition that the country's water problems are much more complex and will require much more than just engineers to address. So what are some of the alternative solutions that you propose?
Thank you so much. This is obviously such a rich sort of conversation, and there's so many things that I want to pick up on here. Just to directly answer your question and then pick up a little on some of the themes that we've been talking about, I think what we need to recognize very much is that essentially since the country's start, especially since the negotiation for the Indus Waters Treaty, right, it basically has been engineers who have led, and there have been large structural solutions. So here what I really want to pick up on Bhatti Saab's point, where he's talking about, look, demand side is what adds the most water. We really must increase our water use efficiency. There's only so much water that you're going to get. Climate change is going to make it more difficult. Essentially, what we need to do, and I'll just put it out there, and I'm happy to be just, I will make this claim. We need to move water that we are using very, very inefficiently out of irrigation. The only way that countries have moved up the value chain and have become successful and developed is by moving water out of irrigation. This is a fact. Irrigated agriculture is some of the most inefficient sort of ways to grow food in the world. I will give you one example. I was talking to somebody from Brazil where they have rain-fed sugarcane production. Rain-fed sugar, basically he was saying to me, why do you guys produce sugarcane? Why do you have irrigated agricultural sort of production of sugarcane? It doesn't make any sense. So essentially we need to figure out what are we efficient at and what are we good at and then maximize those. And you know, we're never going to be able to compete with Brazil on its production of sugarcane, right? So we really have to think of these things in an integrated way. The other thing that I want to put on the table is because I think so much of the conversation around water is as if it's like a thing that you somehow just manage and you build and et cetera. This is an integrated resource. I think we have to bring in many more disciplines. We have to care about the fact that we are a very, in fact, food insecure nation. We're a hungry nation. We're a malnourished nation. We are poor and we are undeveloped. And all of this really matters, and mostly we are deeply unequal. If we get our water resources right and managing them right, I think we can make progress on all of those fronts. So what I want to put on the table is we need to have a bigger, broader imagination. You bring in more people, you bring in more disciplines, and there is a way to do this differently. Rina, I just want to pick up on something that you said, because the per capita water availability is like this big scare figure, and I think it's totally misguided and wrong. Every one of you has a smartphone, look it up, look at per capita water availability country after country after country, okay? Our prime minister, our new prime minister, he was just in Singapore, for instance. Look at Singapore's per capita water availability. It's like hovering in like the 600s, okay? It is not Oman, I mean, think about it. Like, these are rich places, okay? Qatar, Doha, etc. It's not about how much water you have per person, because to live, to eat food, you in fact need very little water. Our problem is that we have too much water, I will say this, doing very little food production, inefficiently, out of which we are giving massive subsidies for food procurement, which farmers can't even get. So what we need to do is having an integrated conversation about poverty, inequality, development, food production, bring everyone at the table, and then let's talk about how do we move forward? Why is our imagination so small? And you know, what are these fights? And there's ways to solve it. Lastly, I happen to be a lawyer by training, and I also just want to sort of put this. The law is a way, and here we really have like expertise, okay? The law is a way to manage change in society. It's a mechanism. So we need to let the legal system act. We need to let laws develop. We have something called the Canal and Drainage Act, okay? I mean, really, it's 140 plus years old right now. This is the base of our legal system managing this water resource. We want to do 21st century agriculture. How do you do it on this legal base? So lawmakers have to step up. People have to step up and say, look, we need serious legal change in this country. This is not fit for purpose, okay? And whatever the British did, and they developed this massive canal irrigation system, we can get into some of that history, it's outdated. And it's not serving Pakistan's real needs of lifting up our people. And it's unfair. So when I talk about this, when I get into this, I actually am very dissatisfied with how myopic. Like, why is our conversation like this little thing? Let's build this. I mean, really, we need to get our water to work for us. Have imagination, do it seriously, bring in more disciplines, and really, I know we're at LLF, but I really think we need to get the youth involved. Every legal, you know, law college in this country needs to be offering courses, for instance, in water law. Why don't we have these people? Why don't we have this development? What are our universities really, really doing? So I have a lot of gripes about a lot of things that we do really badly, but I think we can all put our heads together, build up our disciplines, and work on this in a way that will serve some of these goals. Thank you.
Would you like to respond to what Erum said?
Actually, Erum has been a part of us in this campaign, and I recall that she was very kind to come all the way from America to attend a conference which was held under the auspices of the Supreme Court of Pakistan, which was very unusual thing for a Supreme Court to hold a conference about the water issue which was being faced by Pakistan. Before that, I would, so she knows everything. She has been part of us. Whatever she has stated is absolutely correct. I have no reason to disagree with her or even to give any further suggestion thereto. But one thing I would like people of Pakistan to know much more about, that about the awareness. In our judgment, which is about the water, and that is dated 4th of July 2018, it's a comprehensive judgment authored by myself. If you look at that judgment, we have given the causes. We have given the solutions. That is a comprehensive, detailed judgment, though not in the sense it provides each and every nitty-gritty thereof, but the basic points about the causes. Now, we are not left the causes much. It's a question about the implementation. In the water conference, what we had last year, you must be aware of it.
Yeah.
Everything, every bit of the issues which were being faced by Pakistan or likely to be faced by Pakistan, those have been answered in clear terms. What I feel in our country, unfortunately, it is always the solutions which we do answer, the implementation is the most difficult part.
Mm-hmm.
Implementation has to be done, and if unfortunately we fail in implementing it in our very near future, we'll be little late, both in terms of conservation of the water and also in terms of the user, in terms of the management of the water, in terms of the crops to which she has indicated. So this is undoubtedly a very apt answer given by Erum, that we need to do and take certain steps in that regard.
Do you agree with
that? Yes, I have a slightly different point of view on this. I think as far as the legislation is concerned, pretty good legislation is already available. But we should look to the technology to help us in certain areas. To give you an example, there was a lot of wastage of water in rice fields, rice cultivation, the process of paddy transportation and puddling. You have to pond the field in the water. Recently, there is quite innovative approach, and the paddy is being cultivated just like wheat, that is dry cultivation.
Mm-hmm.
The field is made absolutely level like this, and you only water just like you water the wheat. So the people, once they get to know, they are doing it. In my own village, I'm a farmer also by background, out of 2,000 acres of paddy cultivation, in the very first year there were 300. Next year, there were 1,200 acres cultivated by this method. And the farmers claim that they have saved a lot of money in the tubal bill, which means the water has also been saved. This is number one. Similarly, the wheat is also, in certain cases, water is being ponded and sprinklers are being added. So as the Mr. Saqib Sarsa, ex-chief justice, has informed, implementation is an issue, will continue to be an issue in Pakistan. Law is there that nobody should cross the red light. How many people look at the mall and see how many people cross the red light? They do it. And you do a legislation as it is proposed. Let's say put the legislation to punish the people who overpump the groundwater. It will never work. On the other hand, there will be an army of people who will be recruited, magistrates, and people will try. 1 million tubal, how are we going to regulate it? How are we going to control them? Impossible. So let the people understand, let them have technology, let them have incentive.
They are quite wise farmer. They will save water and help us in overall food security.
Thank you. Erum, going back to you, I think, again, you've written that groundwater is actually responsible for one-third of irrigation requirements in Pakistan. And of course, we just heard that there are over a million tube wells across the country. And yet, there is no regulation on groundwater. It's like the elephant in the room, and not many people discuss it. So what should be done about it? It's a very alarming problem, groundwater depletion.
So on that, so this is such a great question, and if I could connect it to something that Saqib Nisar Saab just said, right? So at Quetta, for instance, it's a different problem. You basically need groundwater for drinking purposes, right? So you're not trying to grow food. So what first, one of the things to recognize is that, look, when we say groundwater, what people are doing with it in different parts of the country changes, right? So it's not just like, well, there's this thing called groundwater, and then, but it's like mini basin by mini basin. So in Punjab, the story is very, very different. When you go to Sindh, you know, Punjab, everyone will tell you, don't line the canals, because if you line the canals, the seepage won't happen. That's what giving farmers groundwater. In Sindh, if you go, there are parts that says, please line the canals, because the groundwater is too salty for us to pump up in any case and to apply to our crops. So it have to be very tailored to the condition of the resource in that specific place. That's the first thing to think about, right? That there's not this one thing, we can't make one law. The other, so, and so, okay, so for drinking water. So essentially in places like Quetta, right? So Quetta city, 8 million people, huge population, right? Water is very, very heavy to pump up. And when groundwater tables are falling, there's not enough rainfall to recharge it, right? And that's the other thing, right? What's your recharge rate? It's a very difficult resource to manage. But so it's also a national security problem, and I just want to put that on the table. Do you, can we think of like 8 million people somehow not being able anymore to live in Quetta City? Then what do you do? Do they have to go live in other parts of the country, right? These are very serious problems. I mean, internal migration, displacement are huge. I mean, you know, you'll get into all kinds of ethnic problems. Who's going to receive them? So I think we have to take it seriously, given the scale of the problem and what the mini problems are. So you'll have to get people on the table and try and get this, you know, get this conversation going. On groundwater, the estimate for tube wells is fascinating because, as you rightly said, there is no regulation. There's no authority at a provincial level, at a federal level, that gives you a license, okay, to say. Now, essentially, people have evolved very sophisticated ways of managing groundwater, okay, around the world. It's possible. It's always, it's like thought of as a free resource, but it's not. So there's a way that you can get a license and you can get a pumping limit. Now, you know, how much people enforce and how good your regulations enforcement has to be, those are ways to do. But there's certainly things that we can look at around the world where people have figured out what is the groundwater resource doing here, what is it doing there, and tailor the response. So there's no one thing that's going to work across Pakistan. That's not going to be it. So you need a sophisticated set of groundwater laws, right, to manage. The other thing is irrigation essentially is under the federal constitution, right? We're a federal country, there's devolution, it's a provincial subject. So the provinces will really have to step up. So anyone who says, I can sit and make something in Islamabad and get everyone to work on this and do this, it's not going to be true. We need capacity to be developed within the provinces so that they can tailor their, you know, resource sort of management.
Thank you. Saqib Nisar Saab, this is my question to you. There is so far only rupees 9.6957 billion in the dam fund. That's less than 1% of the project cost. So the amount is too large to really leave it lying around, and yet it is not really close to even help the project get started. So what do you propose we do?
When we were confabulating about whether this fund should be created or not. And I believe Bhatisa was also there that moment. And we never wanted this, or we never thought this would be, in a way, a money which would be able to complete the project or sufficient for that purpose. Our object was to create a campaign for this. Awareness, make people sensitive about what this issue is and how important and how expedient and how mandatory this is for the people of Pakistan. That is the reason why I remember Bhatti Sahib, why I made the mention to him, is that at the very beginning, I said to them, if through this donation we are able to generate you about 15 billion rupees out of 1662 billion, for example, which was required for all these Diyamid, Bhasha, and Mohammed them, the people sitting in the conference room at that point of time, they were excited. They said this would be great, because we might need this money as a reserve for the purposes of using it at any point of time when we find the paucity of an amount. So firstly, this money was never intended to be used 100% for the purposes of the completion of these dams. It was only as an initiative for people to know about how important this is. And I believe that at a point of time, it really became a campaign, and people have been coming to me. I tell you, the pensioners, they have been coming to me. The two brothers who came to me, and they said, we have 8,000 rupees a pension for both the brothers, and we have saved this 100,000 for our maranjoon, what they call for zindagi bhar ki kamai. So we come here to donate you this 100,000 rupees. I said, no, keep 50,000 with you, and rest we. I matched all the Supreme Court matching. So the small children, they came to me. School boys, girls, colleges, I don't remember any section of the society we did not touch with the Supreme Court for contributing to this. There was a jazba behind it, and I'm sure this is going to continue. And we have suggested in our judgment, which I referred to you just now, 4th of July, we have suggested as to how this dam can be raised with the public investments, with the treasury bills, with the other bonds issued. And you must be remembering in Ethiopia, the dam which is called Jerd, perhaps, that has been created and established with the issuance of the bonds and the treasury bills, and even by creation of a special vehicle companies. So we can do this all. This contribution is a humble contribution to the people, or to the nation, by the people who have love for this country. That's all what I thought to.
Ahmed Saab, if somehow miraculously we get the money and the Amar Bhasha is built, and up, and this is high up in the high mountains of Pakistan, isn't it going to be dangerous? Because the new EC mode, International Center for Integrated Mountain Development, they've just come out with the first assessment report of the Hindu Kush Himalaya region, and they say that although they recognize that this whole region has a total of 500 gigawatts of hydropower potential, of which only a small fraction is actually developed, but then they say that this area faces major challenges due to glacial melt induced by climate change, and that risk of glacial lake outburst floods, which are happening quite frequently, and landslides are increasing. And so it's going to be putting both existing and planned hydropower plants at risk. So how dangerous will this dam be?
Look at this. Definitely these few issues are there, which have been well documented and considered. One is the issue of these glacial lakes, dam bursts that can happen. Then in the lake periphery, these are moraines, which are sometimes unstable, and they could, while the dam is full, and the whole mountain can come and cause a huge surge of water that can overtopple the dam. Now, the first feasibility study that was done by Monenko in 1884, they proposed an earth-fill dam, which was the now, which is like Mangla and Tarbela. But that was discarded primarily for this reason, that it could be overtoppled because of this situation. And an earth-filled dam is very unsafe against overtopping. So naturally, an alternative was considered, which could have been a concrete-faced earth-filled dam or a roller-compacted earth-filled dam. So second feasibility study was done by NESPAC, ACE, and foreign experts.
And they looked into these issues, and the panel of experts who also looked at that, and they considered various alternatives, and ultimately came to the conclusion that a roller compacted concrete dam is the best option. Again, the panel of experts, they look into that. By the way, the original panel of Earth in 1884 had also highlighted these issues, that an earth-filled dam can be overtoppled and is very dangerous. Now, in certain sections of print media, and certain concerns have been raised as to that it's a rigid structure and it's a seismic area, and a rigid structure is not safe against earthfall. Any structure can be designed to withstand any earthquake, depend upon how to design it. For instance, the 2005 earthquake, the buildings which were not properly built in Islamabad, and those buildings which were properly built, including your nuclear power plant, absolutely nothing happened, because they took into the consideration how to design it. So we have, in the latest design review and by a panel of experts, had designed this taking into consideration that the RCC dam will be safe against earthquake, it will be safe against overtopping, and it will be cost effective, it will be constructed within a short period of time, and that is the best option, which is not being considered.
Okay, Ji, thank you. I think we have about 10, 15 minutes left, so let's open it to the audience, and please restrict your questions to water and dams only, and no political questions to be asked. And Mike? And please, no long rambling statements, just ask short, concise questions. I can hear it now.
Just point out, who, like, anybody? Okay. Randomly, or?
The one who's standing is very eager.
Thank you.
My name is Nawaz, and my question is for the former Chief Justice of Pakistan. It's highly commendable, Justice Saab, that you have taken up the cause of building water dams in Pakistan. However, my question is that why don't you specifically champion the cause of building Kalabagh Dam? Because though you have raised voice here and there in favor of Kalabagh Dam, but I think you should be louder than this, because I think Kalabagh Dam is the panacea of every water and electricity problem Pakistan is facing. May I add that I have done my bit in this regard for several times. The first time I raised my voice in this favor was 6 September 1998. When I wrote a full-page article in the English newspaper, The News. Thank you.
Thank you.
Your question has been completely answered in my judgment of 4th of July 2018. And in a one sentence, I would like to reiterate myself that for me, the unity of the country was more important than the construction of one dam. And I believe that Dyamir and Bhasha and Mohammed Dam was the best option available to us at this point of time. And in the judgment, you will find that we have not given up on Kalabagh Dam. The day this consensus of all the four brothers is there, we will, inshallah, make Kalabagh Dam again.
Thank you. Would you like to say something as an advocate of alternative solutions?
Thank you. I just want to put one very quick thing on the table here. And so this is just a little lesson in language and etymology. The English word rival comes from this Latin word rivalis. And who was your rival? What is a rivalis? It is the person you share a water stream with. The very idea of a rival comes from sharing a shared water source. And think about that. That's built into the structure of the language, okay? So the thing to realize is that there is a real water rivalry in this country. This is a real problem, and we're not going to get over it by sort of fudging it and saying, you know, let's get along. It's a real rivalry because it has real economic and social implications. So until and unless you figure out how to have a win-win, the rivalry will persist. The mistrust and the interprovincial mistrust will persist. I think we just have a very sort of, it's like a degenerating cycle of mistrust in this country around shared water resources. So what we really need to do, instead of trying to hammer home a solution, what we need to do is figure out how do we build the trust up of the federating units, and then, you know, we can move forward with different projects, etc. But really, it's an actual rivalry, and there's actual provincial mistrust, and we're not going to get around it by saying, let's go along. This is not like some kumbaya, hold hands, and let's sing, and we'll be okay. This is a real rivalry, and so we need to tackle it with great intelligence and skill. And by the way, we're not the only country in the world that has ever had a water rivalry, okay? I've just done an article comparing the Indus and the Colorado River systems. 7 states of the U.S., the western U.S., very, very dry, and transboundary going to Mexico. So here we have transboundary on the east with India, and we have transboundary on the west with Afghanistan. Why we forget what's happening on the Kabul River and what American plans are for the Kabul River is not, you know, there's a complex problem. So the rivalry is real, competing interests are real, but other places have solved it. And if I just can put one thing, the Colorado River system has 10 million acre feet of water. It is roughly, think of it as 1/10 what we have in the Indus River system, okay, annually. And they have a $4 trillion economy based on that water resource. We need to figure out a different economic model to take care of, in fact, a lot of water that we have.
Thank you, Erum. Next question. And can we move on from Kalabagh? Yes. I think the person in the green sweater is very enthusiastic. So basically, if you want your question heard, be very enthusiastic. Yes.
Somebody sitting in front is asking.
My name is Mirza Faklid Beg. I'm civil engineer, currently working in Kutch Kinar project. So idhar jo discussion hui idhar sari dam ke hawale se, डैम जोन से वो जितना भी अगर हम आज भी स्टार्ट करेंगे तो 15 साल का टाइम तो लेगा, एल्मोर 15 इयर्स का टाइम होगा, लेकिन 15 साल तक जो हम पानी का लॉस करेंगे उसका कौन होगा समझता? हमारा डेली का जो लॉस है हमारा एनुअल 153 हमारा रिवर का है, जिसमें से जो रेन वाटर है वो 45 मिलियन एकड़ फीट सॉरी ग्राउंड वाटर आता है, रेन का 13 से 15 मिलियन एकड़ फीट है। हम 100 वाटर लॉस करते हैं। मैं वो पानी की बात नहीं करता जो कहा जाता है कि सिंध बहा देता है, सिंध को दे दिया जाता है, ये वो वाटर है जो 100 जोन्स है वो हमारे खालों में, दरियाओं में, ये नहरों में, यहाँ पे लॉस होता है। तो इस लॉस का कौन जिम्मेदार होगा और इसको रोकने के लिए हमने क्या किया? हमारे 2 डिपार्टमेंट हैं, एग्रीकल्चर डिपार्टमेंट और इरीगेशन डिपार्टमेंट। इन 2 डिपार्टमेंट की क्या वर्क पे किसी ने कोई सवाल उठाया या इनको कहा है आपने कुछ किया? इरीगेशन डिपार्टमेंट सिवाय सड़कों के ऊपर चूने के साथ लिखने पे जिम्मेदार काश्ता मतवजह हूँ, उसके अलावा क्या काम किए? यहाँ पे डेजर्ट के अंदर गन्ने उगाए जा रहे हैं, चावल उगाए जा रहे हैं, जहाँ पे चने उगने चाहिए, क्यों पानी का आपने लॉस के लिए यहाँ पे कुछ नहीं, कोई काम नहीं करा? यहाँ पे पॉलिटिशियन से बात करें, पॉलिटिशियन कहेगा कि जी इंडिया ने आपका पानी रोक लिया। यार अल्लाह के बंदे, हमारी डिमांड जो पानी की है वो जस्ट 53-56 राउंड अबाउट है, जस्ट इरीगेशन एग्रीकल्चर के पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से। मैं पंजाबी हूँ, माई कल्चर इज़ एन एग्रीकल्चर, एग्रीकल्चर मेरी बैकबोन है, एग्रीकल्चर के बिना हम कुछ भी नहीं है। तो खुदा रहा उस पानी को बचाइए जो कि कुछ भी नहीं है हमारा, 56 का जस्ट है। सो काइंडली फार्मर्स के साथ आके बात कीजिए, फार्मर्स को करो।
थैंक यू अहमद साहब, आपने रिस्पॉन्ड करने।
द क्वेश्चन इज ऑफ कोर्स रिलेटिंग टू सेविंग वाटर। आई डू एग्री वी नीड टू सेव वाटर, but we must realize that we are an arid country, and we have a salinity problem also. A very efficient irrigation is not tenable in such condition. You got to let about 20% water leach down the root zone in order to keep a salt balance. The salt built up in Pakistani lands is like a time bomb. We are adding 1 ton of salt per hectare, and that is keep on being added. So already, I don't think the people, particularly when they're using groundwater because of the excessive rates of electricity, anybody is wasting water. Water is being saved. But what you need to do is that, wherever there is excessive pumping of groundwater, what is the reason for that? We need to have an equitable distribution of water so that there is no shortage of water in the tail. And secondly, we need to recharge the groundwater. The, as you rightly pointed out, we have lots of rain, water goes without charging the groundwater. Very cost effectively, that water can be used to recharge the groundwater. So we have made lots of suggestions and many form that there should be effort, but unfortunately so far no major effort has been done in order to recharge the groundwater. So we, that's an effort which we should do.
Thank you. Next.
Okay, my question was, I mean, why only dams? Why can't we have other solutions? I mean, from what I understand, maybe it's not a problem of supply, it's a question of demand management. And there are a lot of problems with the dams, environmental, for instance. A lot of countries are moving away from it. So they're moving towards flowing rivers. So could you?
Erum, could you answer that?
I'd be very happy to. So yes, you're absolutely right. There's always a trend, right? So meanwhile, while dams are getting made in developing countries, for instance, right? So, you know, Ethiopia, et cetera, there's a major challenge, you know, with what Egypt wants, et cetera. There's also a huge move to try and get away from dams and try and, you know, sort of not build them anymore because they have massive ecosystem challenges that you're saying. So if you go to Kotri Barrage, for instance, which is the last control structure on the Indus, essentially, even in August, there is pretty much no water going down there, right? So there's about 1 million people who live in that delta. So even if you care about poverty and underdevelopment, that is human beings we seem to not really care that much about. I mean, that's the way that we're managing our water. But at other levels, obviously, there's ecosystems, there's species. The mangroves are getting depleted. They're the first line of defense against supposing there's another Asian tsunami, right? Whether mangroves are healthy, I mean, that could really be a buffer zone to when the waves hit, etc. So we really have to, thanks very much for putting that on the table. We have to think in a way which is beyond, you know, it's sort of like if you have a hammer, if you only have a hammer, then all you can think of is like hitting in a nail kind of thing, right? So we have to move beyond one solution to every problem. That's not going to solve our problem. I just also want to pick up on something Bhatti Saab said. Essentially, about 55% of the watershed of all of Pakistan's rivers is outside of the territorial control of this country. That's incredible. Think about this. Basically, we have this huge reliance, population, built-up civilization. That watershed is not in our control, right? If there's a lot of deforestation, there's no river flowing. I mean, there's nothing. I mean, think about that. So we need to figure out how to have a way to evolve solutions, to really even be able to talk to our neighbors where it is in their interest to protect those ecosystems that really we rely on. So we need to have many conversations at many levels. And again, we need to care about species, but really watersheds are important.
Thank you, Erum. Next, please. Lady in the shawl over there. Sorry, we have to keep it gender balanced.
My question is for the poor farmer. How can he implement the modern technology of irrigation? He doesn't have any money. The government is not on his side. So what are the answers? My question is to the young lady on the panel.
Anjiram, Would you like to
answer? I'm very happy to do that. Thank you very much for putting that on the table. That's one of the reasons why we, in fact, need to move away from small farming. You're absolutely right. The British, essentially, the plot size that they gave was about 12.5 acres, right? 12.5 acres was basically subsistence level farming. So you could produce a little bit and your family wouldn't starve. I mean, that's the idea. That's your basically the bulk of the plot sizes. You're absolutely right. There is no ability of that small farmer to do capital investments to be able to move to a different kind of farming. The other thing, this is something Bhatti Saab said, the idea is that you need a lot of electricity, which we don't have, to do efficient farming. There's no ability, right? So we don't have capital, we don't have money, and we certainly don't have electricity. So that kind of farming model or that small farm level is not going to work, basically. You're absolutely right. So as a country, we have to set a direction. Most people should not be in small farming. It's radical, but that's the direction that the country will have to move in. And we certainly need to produce food, we need to be food secure, but the bulk of our people, about say 65 to 70% of human beings in this basin are reliant on some kind of an agricultural income, right? That's incredible, and they could be doing livestock farming. So, you know, where is livestock in this discussion, right? Where are the people who are herders, and like what's happening with the dairy transformation? So you're absolutely right. How do you move money into farming? Essentially, unfortunately, in many ways, you do it when you are bigger. That's a fact.
Thank you.
It takes time.
I think we only have now time left for one or two more questions. So
we can have a few questions.
If you have a really burning question. I think in the front row. Okay, 5 minutes left.
मैं सबसे पहले तो चीफ जस्टिस साहब से मेरा एक सवाल है मैं चेयरमैन हूं ह्यूमन राइट्स कमीशन से और मेरी जो धरती है जिससे मेरा ताल्लुक है वहां मंगला डैम बना है मीरपुर आजाद कश्मीर मैं सिर्फ आपसे यह पूछना हूं कि एक तारीख में 70 साल तारीख में पहली बार एक चीफ जस्टिस आए क्या अल्लाह ताला ने किसी हुक्मरानों को यह तौफीक नहीं दी थी कि उन्होंने डैम नहीं बनाए और यहां पर सबसे पहली बात यह है कि मैं चीफ जस्टिस साहब उस धरती से हूं कि डैम उस जगह बना है नीचे मेरे नाना मेरी नानी मेरा दादा मेरी दादी की कब्रें हैं मैंने इस पाकिस्तान की खुशहाली के लिए डैम बनना जो है वो एक्सेप्ट किया है मेरे लोगों ने इससे बड़ी कुर्बानी बताए जिंदगी कोई है और डैम के लिए मैं सिर्फ आपसे ये कहना चाहता हूं कि आपने एक बात कही थी सर चीफ जस्टिस साहब आपको दर्द महसूस हुआ लोगों ने क्या क्या नहीं कुछ कहा अपनों और बेगानों की साजिशें बिल्कुल मलिया मेघ हो गई मैं सिर्फ आपसे एक उम्मीद रखूंगा मैंने भी अपने बाप की पेंशन से आपके पास आया था मुझे उम्मीद है मैं आइंदा भी ये इस काज को जारी रखूंगा सिर्फ एक बात पूछूंगा आपने कहा था कि मैं रिटायरमेंट के बाद इसका पीछा करूंगा तो मुझे उम्मीद है कि आप पूरी कुव्वत के साथ दयानतदारी के साथ इस अजीम मिशन को पाए तकमील तक पहुंचाएंगे थैंक यू वेरी मच
साकिब साहब
जी मैं इसका जवाब देने का पाबंद हूँ बाकी जो आपने मेरे लिए अच्छे अल्फाज कहे उसके लिए आपकी मेहरबानी दो चीज़ें बहुत अहम हैं जी आपकी कुर्बानी काबिल सताइश है एक आदमी अपना घर छोड़ने के लिए तैयार नहीं होता आपने तो अपने मज़ार अपनी कब्रें अपना हेरिटेज छोड़ा हम आपको सलाम पेश करते हैं आप हैं इस मुल्क की बका और इस मुल्क की यगानगत का एक बोलता हुआ सबूत जो लोग अपनी ज़ुबीने की कुर्बानियाँ दे के इस मुल्क को खुशहाल करने के लिए जो आप कर रहे हैं काबिल सताइश दोबारा ये मैं कहूँगा जहाँ तक ताल्लुक है मेरे पैरा देने का तो इन अ वे मैं उस बात को एक्सप्लेन कर दूँ ताकि ये इबहाम की शक्ल में ना रहे मैंने ये कहा था कि जी इसका पैरा दूंगा मैं आज भी वो कह रहा हूँ कि अगर ज़रूरत पड़ी तो मैं आपके साथ उस जगह पे एक मेज़ कुर्सी डाल के जा के बैठ जाऊँगा ताकि मेरी कम अज़ कम इतनी इखलाकी और मेरे साथ ये मेरे वॉलंटियर्स भी बैठे हैं कुछ ये मेरे साथ जाने के लिए तैयार है देखें इनके हाथ उठते हैं ये चंद लोग हैं दे आर ऑल हम तारवा लेके बैठ जाएंगे लेकिन सर मैंने इसका पैरा ऑलरेडी दे दिया मैं आपको एक्सप्लेन कर देता हूँ ताकि इसकी वजाहत रहो कौम को पता चले हमने एक इम्प्लीमेंटेशन बेंच क्रिएट कर दिया और उस इम्प्लीमेंटेशन बेंच में हमारे माशाल्लाह सारे ही जैद जजेस हैं लेकिन तीन ऐसे जजेस हैं उस इम्प्लीमेंटेशन पे जो वुड बी चीफ जस्टिसेस जो आने वाले चीफ जस्टिसेस हैं उस बेंच पे हैं मेरे साथ उस बेंच पे भी थे जिन्होंने ये 4 जुलाई की जजमेंट दी थी ये है वो पैरा जो उन्होंने देना है हमने हर मौके पे ये डायरेक्शन इशू की है कि इसकी बतदरीज जो प्रोग्रेस होगी वो सुप्रीम कोर्ट में हर महीने आपको देनी लाजम होगी वाडा को और जो भी कॉकअप्स होंगे जो भी हिकअप्स होंगे वो आपने फौरी निशानदेही करनी है ताकि वो इम्प्लीमेंटेशन बेंच रिजॉल्व करेगा एक्विजिशन से लेके और किसी तरह के डिस्प्यूट में आपको एक और चीज़ बता दूँ ये हमने अपनी जजमेंट में लिख दिया है कि ये अमाउंट जो आपने दिया है कॉम को जो आपने डैम के लिए दिया है सुप्रीम कोर्ट इसकी गारंटर है इस अमाउंट को किसी और चीज के लिए इस्तेमाल नहीं किया जा सकता कतई इस्तेमाल नहीं ये हमारी जजमेंट में लिखा गया है और इसको इसको हम गारंटी करते हैं और इसको हम इसकी ऑडिट करवाएंगे हर लिहाज से तो ये जो पैरा है ये भी एक पैरा है लेकिन उसके अलावा अगर मुझे ज़ाती तौर पर इस डैम के लिए अब मैं वो रिटरिक्स नहीं ये मैं अपने ओहदे के हवाले से भी मैं अगर एक चीज़ मैं कहना चाहता हूँ मेरी जिंदगी इसके लिए वक्फ जहाँ मुझे मौका आप गुंजाइश को स्पेस हुई मैं बिल्कुल हाजिर
थैंक यू लेट्स आई थिंक एक लास्ट क्वेश्चन ले लेते हैं हु द सॉरी जेंडर बैलेंस इट हैज टू बी अ लेडी अप देयर ओह अच्छा ओके सो आई हैव बीन ओवररूल्ड सॉरी आई विल try and ask
एक और क्वेश्चन भी वो भी लेना
दीप इकबाल साहब से ही हैज द माइक
अच्छा
पिछले दो दिन से इंडियन टेलीविजन पे और इंडियन उस पर काफ़ी वो आ रहा है ले दे के हम पानी रोक देंगे हम पाकिस्तान को जो हमने पानी दिया है वो गलती की है और आइंदा के लिए हम ये बिल्कुल किसी ट्रीटी के पाबंद नहीं हैं तो मैं आपसे पूछना चाहता हूँ सर कि हाउ स्ट्रॉन्ग आर दीज इंटरनेशनल ट्रीटीज़ आर वी ऑन ए गुड विकेट कैन दे डू एनीथिंग लीगली कैन वी प्रिवेंट दिस legally from happening?
Is this a question for me, sir? Indus Water Treaty, which was executed in 1960, I think is a very foolproof treaty. And if, God forbid, there is such an action or such kind of an breach of the treaty, the international courts are there to implement that. So we should not be worried about this kind of what you may call a political kind of a statement or just a bark. So that's not relevant for us at all.
Thank you. The lady there, Jino, last question, and then we have to wrap up. Thank you, sir.
My question is to the former Chief Justice. So the dam fund is a result of your judicial activism, but there's been criticism against you for this activism. What do you have to say to critics who say that this was a result of judicial overreach?
For the sustenance of my nation, for the sustenance of my country, I'm prepared to take any kind of a criticism. It is for you people to judge whether for making and direction issued for the making of this dam is a bad action on part of the Supreme Court and myself, or it's a good action for the people of Pakistan in future.
Thank you. I think we run out, but I'm sorry, I'm going to have a gender balance. So, Erum, you will have the last word.
Thank you very much. I just want to put one thing on the table here, and I'm hoping we're sitting here in Lahore, there's lots of educational institutes. I really hope that hopefully next year when we come back to here, to LLF, we will really have had I don't want to name institutions, but you know, you have LUMS, which is very famous here. I think we really seriously need a center, an integrated multidisciplinary center that is outside of the government. I think educational institutes in this country need to step up. And I would love to see LUMS, for instance, have a water center, very seriously studying and putting people together. And we need to develop the next generation of expertise. And I really hope that that's what we realize within our lifetime.
Sure. With the permission of the chair, I would like to simply add to what Erum has said. We need to educate our people about saving of the water. And I went to a school, Message Grammar School, about a week or about 10 days ago, and I was very happy to see there that the students, the small student of KG class and even the kindergarten, they were being taught how to save the water, what is the importance of the water in our life. And I believe this should be a subject of every institution, educational institution, where even at a smaller scale, but at least we must make our children aware of the importance of the water and how to use it and how to save the water. That's very important.
Okay, G. I think time is up. Ahmed Saab, would you like to say last word? Since
first of all, I think it was a privilege taking this opportunity of the presence of former Chief Justice of Pakistan here. I would like to sensitize him on a very important issue relating to the implementation of Bhasha Dam, its structural integrity, and I would like to request him and remind him that it's a very complex project, it's a very difficult area, it is the largest undertaking ever taken in the world of that height and that complexity, and something which you had once said, that we would not like to spend money on foreign experts, that was a little alarming because the saving is so small. We want the best of the best in the world to be involved in this project. You will spend a little amount of money, but the amount of stakes that are involved are far more. So I would kindly request you that you have undertaken to protect it. Kindly take care of that see that it is not been done.
Though it may be considered as an intervention, but for the House, I would like to apprise you that you people yourself have been coming to me and telling us that we would like to have more experts and indigenous expertise in the project, and I believe that it is now settled at 40-60 ratio. I believe that is so because you have submitted a report to the Supreme Court of Pakistan in which this ratio has been enunciated and highlighted, and I think the indigenous expertise and skill must be promoted and must be developed also.
I would not like to make a debate on that. I just wanted to sensitize you that the importance of having the best expertise in the world overweighs any other consideration.
Okay, thank you. I think we're really run out of time. Thank you, panelists, for coming here, and I hope you enjoy the discussion. We all have to work together to secure our water future. Thank you.